Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. So this event is brought to you by DataTalks Club, which is a community of people who love data. And we have weekly events. This event is one of such events. So if you want to find out more about the events we have, you can go to the description and find the link with our events. And yeah, you can click there and see what are the events we have. So for example, for the next week on Tuesday, we'll talk about chatbots. And on Friday, we will talk about data governance. And one thing I want to mention is we are going to have a conference. And right now, you can get you can register for the conference on our website as well. So we will have two tracks. We will have a track about career and data. And we will have a track about machine learning production. So do check out. Then to stay up to date with our events, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel, and join our Slack to talk to people about data. To ask questions, you can use the Slido link. So there is a link, pinned link in the live chat. So just click on this link and feel free to ask any question you want. We will cover it today. So that's all for the introduction. And are you ready to start?
Yep.
Okay. And I'm ready to start as well. So this week we'll talk about failures and things in our CVs that we typically don't talk about. And we have a special guest today, Yury. Yury is currently working as a senior machine learning scientist at Elsevier. His main focus at work is natural language processing. And you might already know Yury from ML course .ai, which is an awesome machine learning course. It's open and you can go check it out. And for those who don't know, Yury is the mastermind behind this course. And funny thing, a couple of months ago, we had an interview with Ksenia about transitioning from project management to data science. And she mentioned that course. And on that day, I thought it's a very good idea to actually write to Yury and invited him to this podcast. And finally, this day happened. So we have Yury today. Hi, Yury. Welcome.
Yep. Hi, Alexei. Yep. Thanks. Yeah, it's very cheerful here in The Hague. And I'm pretty happy to join you this Friday afternoon. And I'm always fond of talking about career and all this stuff. So I'm happy to share this experience. Although the topic is a bit controversial, so it might heard some marketing interest of some of the companies, but yeah, I was pretty careful here. So I don't promise that I'll answer all of the questions, but I'm as open as possible.
Yeah, let's start. So, and we'll start with your background. Can you tell us about your career journey so far?
Even earlier than that, well, I lived in Israel for 4 years, then a year and a half in Canada, and then went back to Russia. So I made world around in childhood. And then I was growing up in Russia, and I was fond of aviation. And then thus I joined the best Russian technical university, Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology, the aviation department. Meanwhile, I realized I'm fond of programming. And then, well, Andrew Ng was, of course, the main charismatic guy, the evangelist of the machine learning for me. And then I switched from business intelligence. So I was working for some, okay, I'll tell about the project, but then I switched to PhD studies and I was full-time in academia. That was a bit crazy time, but I don't regret. And then I joined Russian IT giant Mail, the True Group, as a data scientist. But I always searched for some better work-life balance. And that's why we moved to the Netherlands. And through a telco operator, I further joined Elsevier, and it's a good place to combine research. And so it's a nice compromise between academia and industry. So also fond of quantum computing and quantum machine learning. So I'm really a nerd in a good sense. And I think that's it. I've got a small child, a daughter who'll turn a year and a half soon. So she replaced all of my hobbies. So I cannot do the hobbies anymore.
So this is something you need to remove from your CV if you had this section about hobbies, right?
No more hobbies. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and if we ever have an episode about quantum computing, I know who to invite to talk about this now.
Okay. I'll invite some more serious guys.
Okay.
Amateur here.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, so did you find the work-life balance you were looking for?
Yeah, absolutely. So here in Netherlands, yeah, they don't die at work, and I enjoy that.
Okay. Yeah. So the topic today is things we don't share in our CVs. And we all have stories about failed projects. I certainly have a couple. And maybe I will even tell one or two during today. But yeah, since you are the guest today, so probably I will ask you for a couple of stories. One pattern I observed in my career that we as data scientists tend to spend a lot of time on things, on projects that lead nowhere. So we work for a couple of months or something, even more, and then the project turns out to be useless, and then we just waste time. So do you have any stories like that in your experience?
Yeah, for sure. One of the recent stories is a side project for a proofreading service. So basically, yeah, if you want to improve the English language in your paper, you can order the service, which is pretty expensive, I guess. And the question was to automatically assess, yeah, at least preliminary, the quality of the language quality in a given document. So it's kind of grammarly, if you think about it, but more into scientific domain. So it's like some sort of scientifically fine-tuned grammarly. And in our company, we already had some solution. And when I just joined, I realized that while it's the classifier that my colleagues built was very close to noise, the signal that it produced, the binary classification of whether an article is well written or badly written, that was really close to noise when accurately measured. And then I spent a couple of weeks, of course, I tried a couple of ideas. So the proofreading service had a really large data set with some original paragraphs and then rewritten paragraphs. Yeah, these services are typically outsourced to Philippines or India. And so I can't say that it's a golden data set, but still some clumsy phrases are typically well corrected. And then, yeah, if you think about it, you can train a sequence-to-sequence model that would just rewrite the original sentence, but it's rocket science in this sense. You cannot really expect such a sequence-to-sequence model to produce structured language. So my colleagues worked on a binary classification task. So I turned this into a regression problem. So we can measure some distance between the pre-edited and the edited version of the text. So let's say Levenshtein distance. And then you can predict this Levenshtein distance with a BERT model. So they provided some four or five fine-tuned language models. I don't know why so many. And I ran a couple of experiments with BERT regressor to predict this distance. So basically how much a paragraph needs to be edited. And we organized a couple of experiments. So just an annotation experiment between me and my American native speaker. So we went through 50 examples each. And then the conclusion was that our model is about 60% accurate, so in terms of precision. So the idea was that it would highlight a piece of text for the customer, flagging that, hey, this paragraph is badly written, so maybe you would like to use our proofreading service. And then such a highlight would be just 60% precise. And considering that it's a BERT model, which is just a black box, I insisted on closing the project. And the problem with the project was that it was prematurely advertised very heavily. So like the company was waiting for a solution so hard, and even data scientists, my colleagues, promoted this model like LaQua language quality assessment. They called it LaQua brain, like introducing AI to your project, blah, blah, and this shit. And that was a silly thing to do, honestly, because you don't you wouldn't actually advertise your model so hard unless you know that it's brilliantly good. So it's just, you know, hitting up this AI hype. And yeah, that's a story about failing fast. So I summoned all our product owners, my boss, and then just recommended to drop any attempts to build such a service. Because these are the things that are not done with one middle, one junior data scientist, and maybe one senior. So for this task, you need a group of linguists, and a Grammarly team is pretty large, and they've built their service in several years. So my recommendation was to use third-party tools from mm-hmm. that moment. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this actually was the opposite example. So this is an example when instead of spending a lot of time on working on something I don't know, 4 or 6 months, you notice it pretty earlier, then you collected you got all the stakeholders and you told them, hey folks, this is not going anywhere, let's stop it.
Exactly. So that was a pretty hard decision to take because it was my first months in the company, so no one knows me, and then at some point I just show up and say, hey guys, we need to close this project, it leads nowhere. But I had to think this presentation through. I think I spent the whole day actually creating this presentation because it was pretty important at that point.
Okay. Yeah, we have a comment from Pierre saying that's why having a data product manager is so important. So these are the kind of people who can say, so this is not useful for us. We shouldn't spend time doing this. And the story I mentioned, I also have a story, a similar story. And actually back then we didn't have a data product manager. And probably if we had, things would have worked out differently. But the story was, I worked at a SEO company. SEO stands for Search Engine Optimization. And so for SEO, the main idea is, let's say you have a website, and for this website, you want to rank for certain keywords. So let's say if you're selling monitors, if you're selling some hardware, so you want to run to rank on Google when somebody enters in Google Monitors Berlin, you want to be first there. So that's the idea behind SEO. So this was a SEO company. And we wanted to build a keyword recommender project. So let's say we have a customer who uses some keywords, and we say, okay, you seem to be writing about monitors. How about writing an article that would compare 4K monitors versus, I don't know, 8K monitors, something like this, like basically giving suggestions for keywords to rank, right? And if you think about this, this is a classic recommender system. So in a collaborative filtering approach, so you have like this huge matrix, and in this matrix you have rows, which are your users, right? You have, in our case, it was clients. Then you have columns, which are items, like in e-commerce, that could be like phones or whatever. In our case, it was keywords. And let's say you put one, if this customer uses this keyword, right? So you have this huge matrix. And then you use things like alternative least squares or things like this to factorize this matrix. And this way you encode your users and your items in certain vector space, and then you can compute similarity and find and suggest for this user what are the items that could be interesting for this user. So this is all great in theory. And we thought, okay, this is straightforward. We should follow this approach, and we spent a couple of months training this model. So collecting the data, cleaning data, preparing it in the right format, then evaluating it, tuning it, trying different libraries. It was a lot of fun work, right? So this is what data scientists love to do. So we really love doing this kind of work, like Kaggle-like, especially when there is a good data set and we had a good data set. And we had really great evaluation metrics. So after a couple of months, we present it. We say, this is so cool. Let's implement this. We go to the engineers who are supposed to help us. They look at this and they say, no, there is no way we are going to integrate this into the existing architecture. So the problem there was that architecture was based on AWS Lambda. And for those who don't know, like a couple of years ago, there was a very strict limitation on the size of the on the size of your projects, because it should be below 50 megabytes or something like this, which is a pretty tough case considering how many different libraries we tried to put there. So it was very difficult. So we would spend, like there, we spent a couple of months more working with engineers to actually to reduce the size of this package. We even re-implemented some things from scratch because we didn't want to depend on some libraries because they were too heavy. And finally, we did it. And nobody wanted to use it. So that was like, it was a great project, great idea. Then some engineering challenge, which we overcame, but then nobody needed it. And that was very sad, right? Because simply clients didn't care about this. Customers didn't need these recommendations. And so in retrospect, now maybe what I would done, what I would have done instead is just, I would spend a few days to manually come up with these recommendations. So I would select a sample of clients and I would work with a domain expert, with some SEO specialist, to suggest some keywords for these clients. And then maybe just send them emails or something like this, just test if the customers are interested in these keywords. If we see that they are interested, okay, yes, we spent a couple of days verifying it. But if we see that they aren't, we spent only a couple of days doing this manual work, but it saved us 4 months of work. So yeah. This is...
So you just over-engineered having some hypothesis that customers would like a feature, but they turned out not to like it. Well, it resonates, 100% correlates with the book that I'm currently reading, Four Steps to Epiphany. So it's on startups and their business models. And they describe exactly this problem that some startups, they cherish this product model, product development model, which doesn't work really well for startups often. And it's better to switch to customer development model. And they describe exactly this approach where you start with a trial group. You make sure that you are creating a feature that customers need and you are solving their pain in the next, and then you keep iterating in the agile approach. And yeah, exactly, this is a story where you've over-engineered, and there is actually a very important skill not to use machine learning.
Exactly.
That you are acquiring. Yep.
I think I haven't read this book, but I heard about this thing called design thinking. Maybe you heard about this. So it's about what you mentioned. It's about thinking of the customer first and then going from the problem they have and validating things as fast as possible. Okay. And one of the things I mentioned in my story was about this engineering part, about this infrastructure part, when engineers said, hey, no. And this is also for us data scientists, this is what we don't like. So what we like is going to Kaggle, trying different models, tuning parameters, coming up with nice features, with smart features. This is fun, right? But when it comes to deploying models, when it comes to the engineering part behind machine learning, then for many, it's not as fun as that part. And so for me, when I was interested in getting into machine learning, I was actually thinking not about the engineering part, but about this fun part, right?
Yeah.
And I know I watched your talk, which you gave a couple of years ago, when you worked in some advertising company, and you had some issues with the serving layer. And so maybe you can talk about this story. You can tell us in more details what happened there.
Yeah, indeed. I had exactly the same problem where I kept iterating on improving the model while the problem was lying actually in a different place. And as you can guess, it was in the infrastructure around the model. So that happened when I switched from my PhD studies and joined mail.ru group. So it's a Russian IT giant. So, well, everyone knows Google. In Russia, we have a great Google competitor, Yandex. And mail.ru group is maybe the greatest Yandex competitor in Russia. So they also have a search system. And I think in Russia, due to morphology and all the different challenges of the Russian language, so Yandex is still leading. I guess it owes something like 50% of the search market well, Google is very close with something like 47%. And then Mail the True group had this 3%. But these 3% were already, yeah, huge revenue, something like, yeah, billions of rubles, so maybe dozens or maybe hundreds of millions of dollars per year. And we had grading boosting for this search system. So it's highly optimized C++ implementation of grading boosting. And well, you know, boosting can do classification, regression, and ranking with some specific losses. It's very good for ranking problem. And then we had the task of content recommendation. So we had several partners, so websites with different news or with different content, like yeah, Commerçant, Lifehacker, and things like that. And then you know these recommendations like more like this or see also, and then you show some four or five further yeah related pieces of content, and then there is an easy monetization scheme. You just replace one of the recommendations with an ad, and then here is clear monetization. And we had a problem that in offline experiments, in cross-validation, we gradient boosting and all the tree-based methods like random forest were very good. But then when we deployed it in production in the online experiment, we noticed that a heuristic was actually beating the gradient boosting model. And a heuristic was very simple. So in these content recommendation tasks, there is a very strong baseline, just three letters, yeah, CTR, so click-through rate. So you show some ad or maybe some content 100 times, you measure how many times it was clicked, let's say 7, and then you've got this 7% CTR. And for ads, CTRs are pretty low, about typically 1 to 3%. But if you just rank all your content by CTR, in reality, you have to take care of excluding some nudity, some content which cannot be shown. But we worked with partners. We were pretty sure that this content can be shown. And just ranking by CTR is a very good baseline. And our heuristic was mostly based on CTR. So it's like weekly CTR with some trend. We added a monthly CTR with some small coefficient. And then it was only binned into 10 age and gender groups. So that was a fairly simple solution. And then I iterated on improving the model. So I applied active learning. I created different features. I tried to improve the model itself, its architecture, hyperparameters, and so on. So I just, I was still in my PhD program. So I approached the problem as a machine learning researcher. And then in some 3 or 4 months, I actually realized that it's a high loaded system, and the model was limited to some 80 milliseconds to make a prediction. And if it fails, if it times out, you cannot show just a blank. You have to replace it with some quick and dirty solution. And in such serious production systems, they typically have last hope solution. So at least in search systems, they called it last hope solution. Typically, it's a very, very reliable heuristics, like in this case, just sorting by CTR. And in the weekend when everyone's off, and the main production system failed, this solution should work all the times. And I guess there were only two cases when this last hope solution also failed. Not in my practice, but this thing should work 100% reliably. And so what turned out actually is that our gradient boosting solution was timing out at some points in some 10% of cases. And it was replaced with this last hope solution. And in the end, I tested not purely a gradient boosting solution, but this mixture of gradient boosting predictions with these heuristics. And so when I fixed this, it just rocketed. So and the fix was pretty simple. So initially, we also sorted all the content by CTR, and gradient boosting would just re-rank top 1,000 documents. And we just replaced it with 300. So just re-ranking 300 document was working exactly the same in terms of precision and recall and things like all the metrics, and it was much faster. And now the project is bringing money, and all's good. But the lessons that I learned there is that first of all, I spoiled my relationships with a manager at this point. So 4 months was too much for such a project, where we already had a working solution, a nice grading boosting model. And there was a bit of pressure to deliver it earlier. And at the time I launched a side project, this open machine learning course, and I was maybe a bit distracted. And so my personal lesson learned was that, hey, sometimes you need to earn reputation and you need to work really hard on focused on a single problem. And another conclusion was that, it's just going beyond your Jupyter notebook. So in a project, just go to your developers, backenders, ML ops, DevOps. Just make sure what's happening to the model at each stage. So from data collection to training, deployment, then all the way to model lifecycle management. And just, it's good to understand all the specific technical details just to avoid such problems, which are more related to infrastructure rather than to machine learning itself.
Yeah, interesting. So basically, so you had a smart model, but most of the time it was replaced by a simple heuristic, and you found out about that only later or only after running these experiments. And I guess you spent quite a few time trying to figure out what's going on, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I imagine going through all these logs and then trying to figure out what's going on there.
Yeah.
But these things for data scientists, they are not easy. And I remember, when working with data science, even though I had some engineering experience before, so I was previously a Java developer, I think you also had some Java experience before doing machine learning. Anyways, so I remember that the way I was doing things was not far from, best practices. So I would just SSH to the server, to the production server, air quotes. So I would just SSH there and I would do git pull and then it would go, I would have a special branch called production in my git. So everything that is in this branch is the production code. And then I would SSH to the machine, to the production server. And then I would, basically do git pull and it would pull the latest changes. And I eventually even set up a cron tab, like it would pull automatically every minute. So I wouldn't need to actually SSH to the machine. It would just do this automatically. And of course, every time there is some bug, I don't know, even simple things like a syntactic mistake. Of course, I didn't have any integration test there to check before putting there. So let's say in Python, I forgot to put this colon, right? And then basically the thing crashes. And so I would need to SSH to the machine, revert it or do something to fix it. Yeah, it was annoying. Then at some point I left the company and somebody unfortunately needed to deal with all this mess. I heard many complaints, but eventually like real engineers took over and redid everything with proper techniques like CI/CD, all that.
Encouraged you a couple of times.
Oh, I don't think it was just a couple. I think it was because I still have lunches with my colleagues from there, and
they still remember you.
Yes, they still do. Yeah. So did you have anything similar in your experience?
Yeah, exactly. So when I switched teams in mail.ru group, I joined a predictive analytics group, and overall that was a very successful project because it dealt with marketing. And so we had a business intelligence solution, so an app which would create nice dashboards with key marketing metrics like LTV, retention, monthly users, large payments, and it was related to mobile games. And some of the tasks were to identify whales, we called them, so those players who would pay dozens of thousands of dollars per month, so just identifying highly paying users. And so they had a nice app creating reports on these metrics, and I was the first guy to introduce predictions. So just as you create LTV reports, we would then create reports with LTV predictions. And it's a funny experience because we had this startup vibe in a giant company. So although that was a very large company, though in this small team, I was the first guy to set up machine learning pipelines, to basically set, I was setting up the production. I just, just starting with a Jupyter notebook again, just creating some snippets, then switching to PyCharm to create some nice project with, object-oriented programming, some basic tests and so on. But then I would drop these predictions in a CSV file, and another guy, a backender, would pick them up and rsync, so just copy them to another server. And then we have very similar issues here without any CI/CD. We, you know, just if IDs wouldn't match, we would go on SSH and fix problems in this production. And this backender did not like us, so he was cursing us data scientists, because I guess we earned 50% more than him. And that was very annoying that he had to deal with all these issues. And yeah, indeed. So then at some point I migrated to the Netherlands and I dropped the project, but I think now it's successful. So it's in active development. And now guys actually developed best practices there with all the CI/CDs, code reviews, and so on. But I indeed had this startup vibe even in a large company.
You have to go through this experience, right? You have to try to do things incorrectly before you learn to do things correctly.
Yeah. And just going on with this idea of startups. So at the same time, I joined a fintech startup. So one of the huge advantages of companies like, Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, Uber, and all the others. And in Russia, these are Yandex, Mail.ru group, and Sber. Okay, so one of the advantages is the network. So there are many, many smart guys. And at some point, one of the pretty important directors of a huge department, he passed my course, which I gave at Mail.ru group, so on machine learning, and he invited me to join a fintech startup. So the guys were actually, they came up with an idea to sell Bitcoin in a mobile app. Yeah, pretty simple. Such applications, such banks already existed in Europe, but in Russia, I guess they had to solve many legal issues. And Revolut actually existed at that point already. So it was also built by Russians, but then moved to Great Britain. And they already solved these legal issues to sell Bitcoin in a mobile app. So they were doing the same in Russia, but they also bought something like 4,500 GPUs to mine Bitcoin. But then at some point they realized that, you need special hardware to mine Bitcoin, and then GPUs are not cool anymore. And they had this factory somewhere in the center of Moscow, you need cheaper electricity. You need to outsource these factories somewhere to, to hydroelectro station somewhere far away. So at some point they realized they had 4,500 GPUs. And then they needed to sell better. So that's why they included AI in their pitch decks. And that's why I was the first guy doing some AI for their startup. Well, from day one, I told, no, I'm not going to predict Bitcoin prices. I just don't believe in that. Okay, if you have a huge team of very smart guys and you can do something like that in 5 years, but I refuse to do that alone. And I was solving the task of sentiment analysis of on Bitcoin news. Well, the idea was that was to create something like sentiment barometer, which would daily show you the sentiment around Bitcoin. I was simply playing around with some state of the art solutions in NLP. So that was before Hugging Face released their easy to use API. So I would fetch some GitHub repo, spent almost all day just trying to launch something. And then eventually I've beaten TF-IDF and logistic regression by some 3%. And then at some point the startup had troubles raising money, and they decided that they don't need AI anymore. So a solution, eventually my solution didn't end up in production. Or at least it was not bringing money. But that was actually a great experience. And on the go, I also learned that sometimes, labeling can be prohibitively expensive. So we had some Australian financial experts. We had a special Telegram chat with some 15 guys. That was fun just talking to them. But they were labeling this data, and that was prohibitively expensive. So at some point, I switched to a Mechanical Turk. I was also labeling some of the data myself, and we also learned this lesson, like, hey, you can spend too much money just labeling data.
Yeah, and it will still not be good enough, right?
Yeah.
Do you know what happened with the GPUs, with all these GPUs? Did they sell?
Well, at some point they explored the problem, the idea to sell it to deep learning researchers. So yeah, you, on one side you've got these all these miners with many GPUs, and on another side you've got deep learning researchers who need cheap compute, and then you can build this bridge. I know that one startup already did that, and I think this startup also came to an idea to just rent GPUs. I don't know how they got rid of all these GPUs.
Yeah, it would be probably not so easy to get. Did you say 4,500?
Yeah, 4,500. Yeah.
45. Yeah. Yeah, that's a lot of GPUs.
Yeah.
So easy to get it. So many. And then you moved to the Netherlands, right? After working at this startup.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think, did you have this startup on your LinkedIn profile? Did you include it in LinkedIn?
No, not actually. So there was some maybe 4 or 5 months experience. And well, I did not mention them because I don't want any marketing interests to be heard. I don't want to mention this startup.
Okay, so that's one of the things data scientists don't mention on their CV, like small startups that mining bitcoins, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And then you moved to the Netherlands, and and you worked at a telecom company. Can you tell us more about that? What did you do there?
Yeah. So then I switched to NLP, and in this telecom company, I also worked on a huge data, well, not huge, but there is actually a data mining task. So we think of data mining as according to its definition. So you've got a large data set and you want to find some useful signal somewhere there. And so we had exactly this problem. So at the telco operator, we had many chats, calls, emails with different complaints. And actually there is a huge signal there. So there are all the different problems reported via chats, calls, emails. Well, it was all in Dutch, so I used Google Translate a lot. But you can imagine, people mentioned that they are pissed off by some of the services. They have some technical problems and so on. And so I built a service that would just classify these into different broad groups, like billing, general service, churn, so anything related to customer satisfaction and things like that. That was also fun. I had to work with Dutch language. At that time, there were no good pre-trained transformer models in Dutch. And so we explored how we can train a model in English and then run it with Dutch. And so all this multilinguality. And in the end, I worked in a data science department and it was not properly managed. So that was, in general, data science for such a company was like a luxurious car, like Lamborghini. It's cool, expensive, but what if you don't know how to drive it? So I think for these managers of this very old company, that it was a challenge how to manage us. So we had one project which yielded revenue, and there is also a small cool story about this project. So it's called bad debt. So it's very similar to credit scoring. So when you go to a shop and you'd like to take a loan for a mobile phone, they run a model which is akin to credit scoring. And so I went in my first days in the Netherlands, I went to the KPN store to buy a mobile phone for my wife, an iPhone, of course. And then their system rejected my application for a loan. The model was built by my colleagues. So I went to them like, hey guys, why was I refused? So I was literally able to go through the learned coefficients with a SHAP or just visualize coefficients and understand why I was rejected. And the killer feature was residence permit. So I had only a temporary permit for less than 1 year. And typically what scammers would do, they just come to the Netherlands from some other country. They take 100 of mobile phones in loans, and then they would escape and sell these phones elsewhere. And so if your residence permit is shorter than 1 year, you can be rejected. So that was a project yielding revenue, some several millions per year. And that was a carte blanche for us to do research, to explore ideas. So that was cool. So first of all, I had a perfect team there. So just all the guys around me, they were so nice. And it was the working style was so relaxed, especially after Russia. So Fridays, working from home.
You were looking for work-life balance, right?
So I moved to Netherlands for some work-life balance. Yeah. And but we had too much freedom. So I used this time to do research. With Amsterdam Data Science, I launched an initiative on exploring transfer learning in NLP. And that was nice because it led me to my new job. So my would-be boss just wrote an email to me like, hey, I know you from Amsterdam Data Science. Would you like to join as a senior machine learning scientist? In the end, if you, maybe it's a bit philosophical, but if you've got too much freedom and you are lacking some a sense of impact, that's also not good for your motivation. And with all these lockdowns, I switched to another company. And as a conclusion, from that part, so I've got one more good question during the interview. So the question is as simple as, how many projects yielding revenue do you actually have running right now in production?
You mean questions to the potential employer, right?
Yeah, so questions to employers. Uh-huh. Yep. Uh-huh.
And what if they say, zero? So then it's like a red flag?
Well, maybe, yeah. Yeah. So I like coming up with POCs, with these proof of concepts and doing research, but at the same time, I don't want to feel this lack of impact.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's an interesting story. I liked your metaphor about a luxurious car that is cool but expensive. And it's probably not easy to find people, management, who knows how to actually drive this car, especially in more traditional companies like telecom companies. And what I often saw is these companies, they work with consultants like McKinsey, BCG, or whatever. So they talk to them and the consultants say, you don't seem to be doing AI, but you should be. Like, hire us and we will tell you how. So they, of course, hire. And these consultants start saying, hey, you need to hire like 2-3 data scientists. So they start hiring them. And then, of course, consultants are very expensive. So companies and their contracts with them. And so now a company has 2-3 data scientists and needs to figure out what to actually do with them. And I didn't personally experience that, but I heard these stories from other people that at the end, most of these projects weren't successful, and then people would just be left alone, like having too much freedom. So they would spend some time playing Kaggle, but you can play Kaggle only so much. Like, you can play like for 2 months, 3 months, but then like you start feeling bad about doing this at work, right? Just want to remind that if you want to ask any question about anything, you can go to live chat, and there is a link to Slido, which is where you can put a question. And we actually have a question from Vahid. It's not related to our topic today, but I'm curious to know what is your take on that. We already talked about Kaggle a bit, although like doing this at work when your company doesn't know how to keep you busy. So the question is, how important is it to have a digital presence for landing a data science job? Something like GitHub pages, personal data science blog, active Twitter account, Kaggle, and things like this.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's of critical importance, but it's a good additional feature. So I would say the most important part in an interview is just being able to describe your projects, your impact in that project in a disciplined way. And as I tend to see, it gets more and more important as your role matures. So when you are a junior, you might be challenged to, you know, to write a Fibonacci generator or take a derivative of some crazy function. But as you mature, they get more interested in how can you actually change the company and the processes. And that's why it's good to show your experience from other projects, especially if you changed the way the company runs some processes. That's very important to describe it. And so the first exercise that I would recommend to everyone, again, is just to go through your LinkedIn profile and just analyzing your past experience and being able to describe your all of your projects in detail and using active verbs. I think Google has a nice instruction on how to reflect these in your CV. So really stating what was your role in the project, so things like that. And all the rest, I still think this is important. Of course, yeah, my public activities helped me a lot. So like even having an open machine learning course and having a GitHub repo with 7,000 stars wouldn't hurt.
Yeah. I cannot imagine a scenario there it would hurt. Well, yeah, maybe I actually can. I think you mentioned that one of your managers didn't really wasn't really happy about that when you had this important project. I think.
Yeah, indeed. So there is a very subtle trade-off. So I always kept some couple of hours per day for any creativity, reading blogs, writing blogs, and things like that. So maybe it's also a way for me to avoid burnouts. Honestly, I'm not fascinating with an idea to work really hard for the company. Why would you, right? So, well,
let's hope nobody from your current managers. Oh, your current managers are from the Netherlands. They take these things easier, right?
I mean, yeah, absolutely.
Well, in Europe, maybe, usually work-life balance is.
Well, like maybe some of my colleagues are also listening to this talk. But well, anyway, I understand that if you work 12, 14 hours per day for your own startup, if you believe in that, if you think it's revolutionary, you actually have still little chance to rocket with this startup. But still, I understand that you can leave at work working for your own startup. But I honestly don't understand putting so much effort into someone else's company, unless, of course, you are motivated with some stocks and it makes sense. That's why I always left a couple of hours per day, knowing that I would be distracted to some cool stuff, like reading about causal inference or quantum machine learning or things like that. I just found this, well, for me, the trade-off was to, so just one more hack. Yeah, just arrange a meeting with yourself. It's every day from 9 to 1 p.m. You just create a meeting with yourself and it's your focus time. You'll likely won't be distracted. So sometimes, of course, you have important meetings and you are asked to reschedule. But most of the time, you can do your stuff. Well, as a data scientist, you can go into code. And I used that time also to work a bit on my side projects, on my public activities, blogging, shooting videos, and so on. Well, indeed, I had some negative experience with that as well. So this mail.ru project, the first one, was maybe a bit too involved in running this open machine learning course, and my main task at work suffered. So there's a very subtle trade-off here, but I certainly recommend having some public activities, some nice talks. So if you've solved some problem with A/B tests and you can share your experience and you can describe all the nitty-gritty details and the caveats and how you resolve the issues, that might be already available piece of information for someone else. And if you create 5, 6, 7 talks like that, you can already be recognized within closed circles, and that would definitely help. But it's really hard to put a label on it, how valuable that is in terms of spending your money. So it's a very personal, so it's indeed again subtle trade-off here.
Yeah, but I think it is gives you a lot more opportunities that you otherwise would have, right? So one way, let's say, if you want to measure this in terms of money, so then you can see this next time you change a job, you can get a higher bump for your salary, right? So how much you can get? So you can maybe just apply for a job and then you'll get a job. But if you have some online presence, then people will recognize you, and then maybe you can just ask for more money. And then this is how you can measure. Of course, like to do a proper statement, you would need to run a proper A/B test. You need to take a group of people who do not have public activity, then take a group of people who have public activity, and then make them change the job and then see. That would probably take quite some time to run this experiment. But my gut feeling is that it helps. One thing you mentioned is at the beginning, like when you were answering this question, that when you describe you, when you go through your LinkedIn profile, you take your experience, your job, and then you need to measure somehow, to quantify the impact you had on your projects. But what if these projects had negative impact? You basically wasted 6 months of your time working on something that resulted in nothing. And and you decided, okay, you want to look for a new job. Like, how do you, like, because this is the kind of thing we don't mention on our CVs, right? So I wouldn't say on my CV that I wasted so much time of my company working on this project that resulted in nothing, right? So like, it doesn't really put me into a good, light. So it's not, I don't become attractive by saying that. So do you have any recommendations how we can actually have this, active verbs and measurable impact on our CVs when our projects aren't that great?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And so all the stories that I share here, they are about this inconvenient truth that you actually, yes,
exactly.
Yeah, it's self-promotion. It's your LinkedIn profile pursued some marketing goals, actually, which is a euphemism for just lying, you know? Yeah. So yeah, this marketing, self-promotion, putting it a bit more politically correctly, it's not 100% truthful. And I still think it's worth it. So even if you have a negative experience, so you can still sell it. So I think next time I am in an interview, I would describe this language quality project where I actually took a decision to close the project until it's not too late. So yeah, failing fast. So I think it's, first of all, I've got a gut feeling that not so many candidates describe such negative experiences. Mm-hmm. And this can actually underline this difference. So I can, maybe a bit show off just describing my negative project. But I also think it's more about the decision making. So I think next time I can actually describe such a project. But if you just want to put it on LinkedIn, I would say, then probably you don't need to be very specific about all the financial goals in the projects and things like that. So just describe it in general. I have some on my LinkedIn profile. I also have some pretty general descriptions because of all the issues discussed here. Just be sure that talking to your next potential employer, you can defend this project and you can also share some lessons learned from the project.
Yeah, nice suggestion. So we still have some time left. And maybe you have one or two stories you want to share?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I have.
Or maybe just general tips. I don't know. Up to you.
I have a couple more funny projects. Get us back to my youth, probably. I'm also not very comfortable about business trips, and maybe I can share a story about a Russian system integrator. So in my master's, I switched to, I joined a company. Well, it's in Russia and its name wouldn't tell you anything, but it's an Oracle partner in Russia, and they had a very primitive monetization scheme. Half of all the revenue was coming came from reselling Oracle licenses. So for all small different companies across Russia who want to cooperate, collaborate with Oracle, they just go through the system integrator and then they buy the licenses. So it's half of the whole revenue. Another 49% was the revenue coming from a corporate studying center. So they just gave courses on databases, management, Java, and so on. And now only 1% of all the revenue came from the actual development. And that's approximately the role of data science in general in business, just 1% of the whole revenue. Very simple heuristic, yeah. I was still a student, so I spent more than a year in a corporate center, so I need to be grateful to this employer. So yeah, they invested a lot into me, so I studied all the even Hadoop at that point. But then when I joined the actual projects, I went to Russian city Perm. It's almost Siberia. It's very close to Ural Mountains. So yeah, you've got this Ural Mountains separating Europe from Asia. And so Perm is just a bit to the west from Ural Mountains, and to the east, yeah, it goes, Siberia starts basically. Oh, well, so I went to a business trip where I needed to, at the time I worked as a business intelligence architect. So the work itself was actually pretty good. So at some times challenging. So you work with a corporate data warehouse, then you need to build some logic around the warehouse. And then you also have a presentation layer. And the final goal is to make creating reports very easy, so that you just with a couple of clicks, you create a nice dashboard which you can show to your manager, CEO, or anyone. So sometimes it was challenging. I needed to think well, but
think at work.
Yes, sometimes. But at the same time, this business trip was really crazy. So they sent us in winter in Perm, it's minus 30, and project manager didn't take into account that we actually live in a hotel in the weekends. So the financial sheet wasn't actually thought through well, and they just made us work in the weekends as well. And that was the taxi would pick up us up at some 7:30 a.m. And then again at minus 30, it was windy, so we just jump into the taxi. So the taxi drives us to the company, and then we sit there till 8 p.m. and then back another taxi back to the hotel, and then you don't see the sun at all. And I had three business trips like that. One of them was just 3 weeks in a row with weekends, so just 21 days in a row. At some point I said, no, I don't care. After all Saturday at work, I just said, no, I brought I played ice hockey with Perm, with guys from Perm. I just said, no, I'm not working on Sunday, but of course I could have been fired. I don't know. So now I'm maybe a lesson learned from these stories that you need to be careful actually with the business trips. I also have a feeling that you have to work more in a business trip and to satisfy your customer. And I, to be honest, I just don't enjoy this business model where you have to satisfy your customer. So because, well, these data science projects, at least data science projects, they are very risky. So you always have a risk that the project is not profitable. And then you gradually turn into your customer's slave. I don't like that feeling. And as for business trips, maybe someone would argue, of course, it's a way to explore the country, the world. But what I also see in Naspers, let's say, yeah, I know your company belongs to Naspers.
And yes. We have
its headquarters here in Amsterdam. And I know the guy from this company. It's a crazy lifestyle. So this week, you're in Brazil. Another week, you're in Guinea, then to Russia. And of course, it's very challenging for your work-life balance.
Yeah, well, now things are different. Now they don't need to travel that much because, well, things are in Zoom anyways. But maybe next year the life will get back to normal and they will be back to on the plane again.
We'll get back to their normal.
Yeah. Or maybe somebody somebody will not. Yeah, so it's time to wrap up. Do you have any last words before we finish?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, well, these failures are fine to some point, well, unless you're fired. And I think it's a very nice experience, and it's good to understand that, well, all the people around you, they're not all of them are much better than you. So there is only one, well, maybe 0.3% of people are, of course, smarter than you, but all the people, all your colleagues, they are not robots. They're not bringing millions every year to their companies. And so it's, well, important to understand that they also have their failures. So I think it's good for your self-esteem. But at the same time, these failures are very important, I think, to live through. So it's okay to make mistakes. And so you can listen to talks like this one, but it's still important to just feel it with your own skin. And whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Yeah, right. So you have to try doing these things SSH into your production environment and then deploying things through Git, right? To feel like how good things can be, like when you do it properly.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not recommending to do this actually, but it's something that by doing this, you see the benefits of doing things normally. Like the right way.
Yeah. So finally, finally, I can only wish you all the good failures that don't make you leave the company.
Yeah. Thanks. How can people find you?
Twitter. Whoa. I have to recall my nick there. I think it's.
I'll put this in description.
Okay. Okay. Great. Yeah. So
Twitter, LinkedIn. What are the?
I've got a YouTube channel. Yeah. So I'm mostly active, I guess, on Twitter. Yeah.
Okay, so I'll put your Twitter in the description, and if people want to reach out to you, they can use Twitter. Thanks for finding time to join us today. I know you have a tight schedule. This is the third talk you give today, so I imagine that now you want to take some rest from talking, maybe drink some hot tea. I don't know. Yeah, so thanks for joining us today, for sharing your experience with us. Thanks for talking about things that then like not everyone would be comfortable talking about things like this, so thanks for doing this, and also thanks for everybody for joining us today and for watching our chat with Yury.
Yep, my pleasure. Yeah, thanks for having me.